Well, yeah, what's your theme for the next difficult dialogue? The last one's on trust in democracy. Yeah, trust ended up being an important theme this semester because Rosen was talking about trust too. Important. And it came up last fall with Putnam. So much synergy. I kind of couldn't believe it about Jennifer Clement having been the author of the thing, of that letter that Jay talked about. That was cool. I kept bringing it up and I probably should have let it go, but I was really surprised by that. That was a big deal. So much synergy. Oh, wow. Yeah. Her hanging out with Warhol and Madonna and such. Listening to her talk, I thought she sounded kind of like Madonna a little bit. Had Madonna's accent. Whatever that accent is, which it's not from Michigan. As a girl from Michigan, I can tell you that's not how we sound. I know Karen was checking on the cookies. Did we hear what happened to them? Oh. Busy. Busy cookie day. Well, hopefully we'll have them by the end of the thing. We start 5 after because it takes folks so long to get here from wherever they are. So we might. Waited too long. Lost 2 of them. What do you think?
Oh, it's 5 a.m.
All right, howdy everyone.
Howdy.
Thanks for being here. I am Dr. Jennifer Mercieca. I'm the director of the Aggie Agora, and I'm thrilled to welcome you to our very last fact check workshop of the year. I can't believe that a year has gone by so fast. We do this once a month. We have 2 workshops in our regular series, a fact check workshop and a difficult dialogue. Difficult dialogue is run by the Aggie Agora graduate fellow, Jess Gant. And those are really great interactive conversations where you get to debate sort of town hall style with a group of students around some issue relevant to the theme for the semester or the month. We've been doing these workshops for 2 years. The Aggie Agora has existed for 2 years for some of you. This might be your first time being here. How many of you, this is your first Aggie Agora? A bunch of you. Hi, welcome. We're so glad you're here. I'm sure you're here because of class. Yeah, mostly. We try to have really interesting and engaging speakers. So if this is your first time, I'm glad somebody forced you to come and hope that we'll see you again soon. We're almost done with our program for the year. So this semester we've been talking about our theme of a more perfect union. And we've been trying to think about things that bring us together, that unite us, and also ways to perfect the union or improve the union. After the sort of divisive election, you can imagine that those are important conversations to have. And so we have just a couple more lectures left. One is going to be about the relationship between trust and democracy, and another one is about regulating the internet, I think is his deal. And so look for those on the Aggie Agora schedule. And of course, all of our events are free and open to the public. You just have to register in advance, and they will sell out, particularly the last lectures, because everybody waits to the last minute to get credit for whatever class they need to get credit for. But I'm going to talk about fact-checking. This is an increasingly noteworthy thing, but what I'll talk about today will be the history of fact-checking, so you'll see that it dates back to, at least officially in terms of calling it fact-checking, 1992, in the 1992 election. We'll look at how it got sort of politicized during the 2012 election, and then we'll look at some sort of recent trends in fact-checking and some ways that different organizations are trying to promote fact-checking. I'm also going to give you some fact-checking tips so that when you leave here today, you will be wiser communicators and wiser consumers of political news and information, or all news and information on the internet. So something we can all be reminded of. One fact, this is a real fact, that I read today that surprised me, although it shouldn't, is that 6 out of 10 people will retweet or repost a link without having read the article, just based on the headline alone. How many of you are guilty or will admit to have done that? Some of you are not being honest, because 6 out of 10 would be more than that. And I can see that if you look at your statistics, your analytics on Twitter, at least, and Facebook doesn't do this, it'll show you how many times somebody clicked the link, and it'll show you how many times it was retweeted, right? Those numbers never match up in my world. I don't know about yours. But so fact-checking is something that we should all be thinking about. And if you're not reading the link, you're not reading the article, then you have no idea what is said, actually. You just retweet and recirculate bad information. So we'll talk about that as well. I want to start with this video. It's a short video, but I think it brings out some important and relevant things about current issues. And
at the start of 2016, in a small town called Veles in Macedonia, an 18-year-old high school student discovered that he could make more money than his parents by building fake news sites. To protect his identity, we'll call him Boris. And here's how he did it. He wrote tons of false articles about the US election, most of them salacious. The articles were shared on Facebook, garnering tons of traffic. So much so that Boris's most popular website earned him $16,000 over the course of a few months. That's way higher than the average monthly salary in Macedonia, which is $371. So, Boris dropped out of high school. And he was not alone. In the final weeks of the election, there were more than 100 political websites registered to Veles. The most popular stories were pro-Trump, but that's not because Boris and his fake news publishers liked the candidate. They just liked the money. Trump supporters just happened to be more likely to share fake news. Researchers tracked 30 million shares of pro-Trump stories on Facebook in the months before the election. But why were companies advertising on fake news sites? They weren't directly. Those ads were placed by services like Google AdSense or AppNexus, which act as intermediaries between advertisers and small-time publishers like Boris. They negotiate how much ads cost and manage payments from advertisers to publishers. Those ads follow people wherever they go online. Remember when you recently searched for that onesie Well, that search was tracked and matched with advertisers selling that product. So everywhere you go on the web, a onesie ad follows. Advertisers and these services create blacklists of sites they won't advertise against. But it's hard to keep up. So sometimes they pop up on fake news sites that haven't been discovered yet. While Boris and his friends were making money, fake news became one of the major scandals of the 2016 elections. Many wondered if sites like Boris's even helped Trump win. A joint study by NYU and Stanford University found that it may not have tipped the election as much as one would think. It found that one fake news story would need to be as persuasive as 36 TV commercials to swing a voter. Still, the backlash forced tech giants like Google and Facebook to do something. Facebook is now partnering with fact-checking organizations like Snopes and PolitiFact to flag articles that present deliberately misleading content. Google now cuts off AdSense revenue to sites with spoof domains like NewYorkTimesPolitics.com. But that's still flagging fake news after it's been published and shared. So tech companies like Moat propose combining algorithms with human insight to catch fake news before it spreads.
What I like about this documentary thing, this little explainer, is that it shows that fake news is not partisan necessarily, right? So it might be promoting a political party or a person or an agenda, but the reason why it's being posted is about money. It's about making money. It's not necessarily about supporting that agenda, right? So these kids in Macedonia, they didn't necessarily care about Donald Trump. They just knew that if they posted things that were supportive of Trump, it would get recirculated. And they probably learned that through trial and error, right? So they probably tried to post things that were supportive of Hillary Clinton or of Ted Cruz or one of the other candidates, found that more people were interested more in Trump, right? And so then posted more things related to him. Just a matter of dollars and cents. It's not in any way related to politics. And so fact-checking is a way of debunking or preventing the recirculation of bad information. So information that's completely made up. We'll talk about that a little bit more. Let's see if I can figure out how to make this thing work. So here's another graph related to the election and fake news. So you'll see that the total Facebook engagements for the top 20 election stories, that of the ones that were fake news from Boris and his friends, 8.7 million stories circulated. From the ones that were from the mainstream media, 7.3 million circulated. So a real problem in terms of just the plentitude of information. And what we know is that people primarily get their news through Facebook, right? So more people will click on a link to find a news article from Facebook than they will from any other method of acquiring news. Used to be, 5 years ago maybe, people went to the homepage of the news organization and read all of their content. So sort of like, you know, your parents would open the newspaper or your grandparents would open the newspaper and read all the stories. People used to do that, but they don't do that anymore. People don't just go to the New York Times and start their day by reading their website, or at least statistically they don't. How many of you all do that? Go to the website and just read? Yeah, that's good, actually. Well, statistically, you guys are not in the norm. Most people will get their news actually from Facebook or from some other social media site. So the fact that more fake news information was circulating is important. What do we mean by fake news is also controversial. So Tim Dickinson is, a reporter, and he says, fake news is lazy language. This is on Twitter. He says, be specific. Do you mean propaganda, disinformation, conspiracy theory, or clickbait? Let's talk about what those differences are. What is propaganda? Awesome.
But if from a government perspective, it's trying to get the people to line up their views with what you want.
Yeah.
Or beliefs, or make them do something or feel a certain way.
Yeah.
It's kind of just about manipulating someone into doing it.
Very good. And so it can be done by a government organization. Propaganda could be done by a political party, could be done by a NGO or some kind of other organization. Yes, sir. Oh, okay. Right, but so what it is, what I like to think of propaganda as is somebody sort of trying to get their message through to a person or a group of people without allowing them to think critically about that message, right? So lots of different techniques for propaganda. If you look at the early 20th century when propaganda studies, and you know this because you did the history paper, when propaganda and propaganda techniques really emerged was during World War I. And they started in Britain and in the United States and in Germany all about the same time. And then they really sort of developed more sophisticated propaganda techniques between World War I and World War II. And at that time, it was really about slogans. It was about repetition of ideas or information. It was about using symbols, right, to try to get people to have emotional responses and identify with your state or your organization. And so propaganda is kind of one-way communication. It doesn't ask people to think critically about the information that's being received. It just tries to sort of impart it to others. What's disinformation? Yeah, false information. So if somebody says A, then a disinformation campaign might say, no, it's not A, right? If you're right now, there's United is having some troubles in the public relations department. And so they might try to start a disinformation campaign that says, no, our policies about forced removal are really generous. I don't know, because they're being critiqued for not having nice policies. And they might just recirculate that information over and over again, hoping that they could change like public perception. Right? So taking something and trying to change the spin on it. What's conspiracy theory? So I like to think of, so there's a lot of power at stake in calling one thing true and another thing a conspiracy, right? And so since it's laden with power, I like to not call it crazy, but like to say that a conspiracy theory is something that can neither be proven or disproven, right? It's something that circulates and you can't prove it one way or the other. And the more it circulates, the more people start to believe it, and they may in fact layer historical events on top of it so that if you start to believe one thing is true, then other things start to sort of pile on and become a part of the narrative and whatever. But you can never really prove the first thing, and so all the other things also can't be proven. But you also can't disprove it, and so that's where they take hold and they become really entrenched in a society. All right, and then finally, what's clickbait? Yeah, you'll never believe what these child stars look like now, is one that I always have to force myself not to click, because I do want to know, but I don't want to fall for it. I don't want to reward those headline makers, right? So all headlines try to grab your attention. They all try to make you interested in the topic. But, you know, there are ones that do so in such a way that, it makes it really difficult to resist. They really prey on our vulnerabilities for gossip and for, cute puppies and whatever, right? It depends on what it is. But they're designed only to get people to click on the article in order to sell advertising. They're not designed to share information. They may be fake news. They may be entertainment. They may be disinformation, propaganda, they may be any of the other kinds of things, right? But it's not the point. The point is always to click the link and sell ads. I used to do a thing, a previous version of this, where I showed, this Matt Damon is moving to my town thing. Have you seen this on Facebook? Yeah, that's clickbait. Matt Damon is not moving to your town. His car did not break down in your neighborhood. Like, There's different versions of it with different actors and actresses, but it's really just a fake news story that's meant to sell advertising. Okay, this is a busy chart, but I think it's useful. I'm going to show it to you again at the end of the session here. But what this is, someone who analyzed the media sort of system, and she has organized existing news organizations based on whether they are more complex in terms of the information that they provide versus sensational or clickbait. The middle is meets high standards. And then also whether they're liberal and conservative, right? So how much partisan bias they have versus how deep of a reporting they do. And you can see that the sort of middle sweet spot that she recommends here are organizations like the BBC, NPR, New York Times, Washington Post, Associated Press, Reuters, ABC, CBS, NBC, right? So it's traditional mainstream, well-researched news. Not that they're not biased and not that they're, you know, perfectly complex, but that they're a good mid-range. You're going to get solid information from these sources most of the time. Not all the time, but most of the time. And then moving out from there, you know, you can have sort of in-depth, complicated reporting, but in a more partisan way. So you can have things that are liberal, so like The Atlantic and Slate, Vox, The Nation, are pretty well researched, but, you know, partisan. And you can have the same thing on the right, The Hill, National Review, Financial Times, Economist, smart, but also partisan. So if you're reading those on either side, know that, you know, you're getting a little bit of an agenda there. You're getting a little bit of perspective, but that it's pretty much trustworthy information, well-researched. As you get further down here, you'll see not as well-researched. Even the ones that are mainstream, so this is USA Today and CNN, they're not as well-researched, but at least they're sort of not biased in too much of a direction either way. But then over here you have things like Addicting Info, Occupy Democrats, and over here you have things like Breitbart and Daily Caller, The Blaze, InfoWars, etc. Right? So you probably want to treat with skepticism information that comes from here on either side, and even here, although I sort of trust CNN. I don't know about you guys. And then maybe trust more these folks here in the middle, just as a rule of thumb, which makes sense. Are we post-truth? It was the word of the year. 6,000% increase in usage of the word post-truth. What do you think that means, post-truth? Yeah, are we in the era of post-truth? And if so, what does that mean? And if not, what does it mean?
This idea that beliefs are more important than facts.
Yeah. Do you guys agree with that? Are we in a post-truth era? Do we want to be if we are? What do we think about being a post-truth era?
It kind of feels, for me at least, it kind of feels like simultaneously post-truth and like the age of truth. Because there's so much information and some of it, know more about the world than anyone ever has been able to.
Yeah.
but it's also almost impossible to find out what's true and what's not.
Yeah.
Some spins being put on it.
Yeah.
Some European kid is writing articles that
right?
are true.
You had no idea, and you would have no idea. Yeah, I think I feel that way too. I sort of feel overwhelmed. Anybody feel overwhelmed with information? I feel like there's so much. And you could probably find whatever you were trying to find confirmed by some article, some website. And so it can make it really difficult to know who to trust or what to trust. And so post-truth, I don't actually think we're in a post-truth world because I think facts matter and still matter, will always matter. But I can definitely see why there would be so much concern. It kind of feels like that. It feels like we've become unmoored from truth. And maybe that's been developing over time. Trump and Clinton supporters cannot agree on basic facts, turns out. So this is a Pew Research survey. Pew Research, if you're not familiar with them, they're a nonpartisan fact tank, I think is what they call themselves. They do a lot of surveys, which I really enjoy reading their information. And so this one was conducted before the election, September 27th through October 10th, 2016. They should always tell you when they conducted their poll, right, for research. And what they say is that 81% found that we do not disagree, not only disagree over plans and policies, but also cannot agree on basic facts. So people during the election felt that on both sides, right, that this was true, that not only is the conversation so far apart on policy, like what we should do, but also just on fundamental agreement over what the facts are. If you can't figure out what the facts are, then it's really hard to figure out what we should do about anything, right? And so they believe it's a problem.
What were the facts? Do they say, like,
oh, like on any particular issue?
Well, in this study, what were
I don't think they asked them about a specific issue. Okay. I mean, they probably did in other surveys, but yeah. I mean, this is just in general. Right? Like, we can't solve any problems because we can't agree on facts. It's trouble. Yet, they believe that fact-checking is the media's responsibility. So a majority of Trump and Clinton supporters think that fact-checking is the media's responsibility. All voters, 65%, thought that it's the media's job. And this is noteworthy because right now there is so little trust in the media. If any of you were at Dr. Jay Rosen's talk a few weeks ago, he is an important journalism critic from NYU. He came and talked to us about how to restore trust in journalism. Part of his argument was that Americans as a whole have like 13% confidence in journalism right now. So really low, and as low as any other sort of leadership, right? So we don't have a lot of trust in the government. We don't have trust in lawyers, in clergy, in the media. The only people that Americans actually do have trust in right now is the military. Y'all. We like y'all. Otherwise, we don't, you know, Americans don't know who to trust, which is a problem. If you don't know who to trust and you can't agree on basic facts, you can't figure out how to solve policy problems, what are we going to do? Right? You can't trust anyone else to solve the problems because you don't trust them. You can't have conversations with one another about how to solve the problems because we don't trust each other to have good facts. We're really in a quandary, sticky pickle, right, in this country. So what is fact-checking? According to PolitiFact, and if you came to the Aggie Agora Election 2016 conference, we had the executive director, Aaron Schrockman of PolitiFact, come. And he says that fact-checking isn't so different from traditional journalism, but it does have a different outlook, specifically a relentless focus on evidence. When you're fact-checking, your goal is to uncover all the evidence. So why would that be different from traditional journalism?
It's more meta-journalism. You're checking what other journalists are doing, and then you do your own investigating on their stories.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a really good point. One way to think about journalism and what journalists do is that they're reporters, right? What does a reporter do? Kind of right there in the word, right? A reporter reports, meaning that they're kind of like a court reporter, right? A court reporter sits in a courtroom, types down everything that is said, and reads it out, and writes it down for the judge to look at or for posterity, whoever is looking at whatever the thing is. And their job is literally just to write down what other people have said. So this is very different from that, right? So this isn't just telling us that so-and-so said this thing, but it's actually analyzing the truth of the thing that was said, right? So not just reporting what the spokesperson wants you to believe, the perhaps propaganda, right, of the person whose job it is to convince you to think a certain thing, but actually interrogating that thing. So it's different, it's very different. And for a long time, journalism operated under the norm of objectivity that said that it's their job to report the facts as objectively as possible. They present side A, they present side B, and they let people decide which side is right. Right? And it changed over the course of the last 25, 30 years. to be more fact-checking, but not always. So we'll talk about the history of fact-checking. It began during the 1992 election, and I'm going to show you a clip here. I think. Okay, so in the 1992 election, we went from reporters merely reporting, this is what happened on the campaign trail today, to reporters starting to evaluate what happened on the campaign trail today. So here's an example, early example of this happening.
Leaving his kinder, gentler persona behind, George Bush circled Arkansas like an angry hornet, hitting six different states yesterday to ridicule his opponent. As with most political sojourns, he used both facts and partial facts arranged for political impact in trying to sting Clinton.
He has more than doubled Arkansas state spending since 1983.
True.
And he has paid for it by raising the taxes that hurt poor and working families the most.
It is true that the Arkansas sales tax has gone from 3 to 4.5 cents. Clinton had little choice given a state constitution that effectively blocks income tax hikes. Bush didn't mention that Arkansas taxes are among the lowest in the nation.
Governor Clinton's state had the biggest increase in the overall crime rate in the entire nation, nearly 28%.
Clinton's campaign did not dispute that figure. But what the president didn't mention is that violent crime in the U.S. has gone up more than 14% during his watch.
During the 1980s, Arkansas fell from 47th to 48th place in percentage of adults with a high school diploma.
True, Arkansas, a poor state, ranks near the bottom on many educational yardsticks. But the percentage of students who graduate high school improved. And Mr. Bush himself praised Clinton for his contribution to a high-powered meeting on the future of education.
Governor Clinton has still not brought a civil rights bill to the people of Arkansas.
It is true that Arkansas and Alabama are the only two states without a civil rights law. But time out. George Bush's civil rights record is less than pristine. He vetoed the Civil Rights Bill of 1990. And when he ran for the Senate in 64, he campaigned against the Civil Rights Act. He built his 88 campaign around the Willie Horton issue. The president also hammered Clinton for taking campaign contributions from the poultry industry, which pollutes some rivers. That's true, but federal records reveal that the Bush campaign has also accepted thousands in chicken money, some of it from Arkansas. Eric Engberg, CBS News, Washington.
Okay.
Obama ad running now says a top McCain advisor lobbies for oil companies, Charlie Black. The truth is, Black used to lobby for oil companies, but not anymore.
Actually, nobody who...
Sorry. Okay, so what did you notice about that news report? I'm going to get us going again. Oops. There. What did you notice about that news report?
They only reported like what they wanted the audience to hear.
Yeah, so they selected elements of his speech and presented them to the audience. Very good. So they didn't give all of his speech or speeches. Yeah. Just certain elements of it. What else? Did they just let Bush say whatever Bush wanted to say? No. What did they do? Or gave more information or more context, said it was true, evaluated it, hold on, wait a minute. How was the tone for you? What did you think about the tone of the relationship of the report to the reporter to the president?
Seemed
antagonistic, right? That there's a sort of adversarial relationship between the reporter and the president. And that's new. It's not invented in 1992, but it is something that emerges, right, post-Watergate. Journalists start to get more adversarial, more critical of those in power, and so does the nation, right, fundamentally. But you start to see more of that in reporting. At the very end of the report, right before he talked about the chicken money issue, he mentioned the Willie Horton ad from the 88 campaign. Does anybody know what that's about? In 1988, George H.W. Bush ran ads saying that Governor Dukakis of Massachusetts, the Democratic nominee, was weak on crime. And as evidence of that, he showed ads of this guy named Willie Horton, who supposedly was let out on a furlough or something like that from prison and then committed a bunch of crimes and then, I guess, went back to prison. I'm not sure. But it turned out to not be true, right? And in 1988, nobody really criticized the veracity of those ads. They just sort of let them be out there, and they didn't tell that story better than it was told in the ads. And so the ads sort of stood on its own, and it really influenced how people thought about Michael Dukakis. And not necessarily that Dukakis would have won if it hadn't been for those ads, because who knows? But the media, I think, felt a little burned by it. They felt like they had been duped or that they hadn't done their job. And so by 92, they get a little bit more aggressive and a little bit more willing to question campaigns, which, as you know, has only continued. In 2003, the Annenberg Public Policy Center partnered with Brooks Jackson to form factcheck.org. So it took a decade for that to happen, and other fact-checking organizations followed. Has anybody heard of the Annenberg Public Policy Foundation? One of you has? What do you know about Annenberg? Do you know anything about them?
I have that
USC. Yeah, they have one at USC, and they have one at Penn, University of Pennsylvania. And they are nonpartisan. So if you've ever been to the Bush Library, the Bush School of Government, Bush Conference Center, that is funded by the Annenberg Foundation. So they do things to fund programs on the left and programs on the right. They're really about politics. That's what they care about. They're not political. They just want to help fund things that are political. So we have an Annenberg Center on our campus. There are, though, partisan fact-checkers, also known as opposition research or rapid response teams, as well as nonpartisan fact-checkers. So in the last year, the nonpartisan fact-checkers have become politicized in that when somebody does a fact-check, if they don't like what the fact-check says, then they say that's partisan. And they try to make them seem like they are partisan, but in fact, there's differences between the ones that are overtly partisan and the ones that are nonpartisan. I used to have examples. All of the partisan fact checkers have closed up shop for now. But I used to have examples of the Clinton campaign's opposition research, rapid response, as well as the Trump campaign's. You know, you could get emails from the Clinton campaign that would say things like, be a factivist, a fact activist, right? So take the facts that we're giving you and spread them around. Same thing for the Trump campaign, right? And every other campaign. These are the nonpartisan fact checkers that I trust. Snopes.com tends to do some political things, but also lots of non-political things. So, you know, you see the story about Matt Damon moving to your town or whatever. Snopes has probably got some information on that. Factcheck.org, Fact Checker, and PolitiFact are primarily about politics. Fact-checking has gone worldwide. There are fact-checkers that are operating right now in Sweden and in Italy and right all over the world, South America, everywhere. And they're doing really good work. So if you saw any of the information that came out of the Panama Papers, anybody know what I'm talking about with the Panama Papers? So a big trove of information about how government officials hide their money and spend their money and launder money and where it hides and how they hide it, all of that. was released to some journalists in Norway or Sweden or somewhere like that. And they decided that the story was too big and impacted too many countries for them to actually be very good reporters for it. And so they shared that information with, in fact, they just won a Pulitzer for doing this. They shared all of that information that they had with reporters from around the world. And they generated thousands of stories exposing all of this corruption worldwide. So nonpartisan fact checkers are a big deal. I sort of like PolitiFact the best, and I'll show you an example or two from them. And the reason why I like them the best is because they show you their sources on the sidebar of their story, and so you can click on the links and kind of judge for yourself what you think, which to me is important. Google and Facebook got into a lot of controversy over fact-checking, not fact-checking, how they were doing fact-checking, which stories they fact-checked, which ones they didn't fact-check. Big disaster for both. And so both of them are trying to do something, and they keep trying different things. Right now, this is their current new innovations. So this isn't very big, but what they've done is they've partnered with those organizations that I showed you on the last slide. And so this is me searching, did Trump say Muslims celebrated on 9/11? And here is the first thing that pops up now is a PolitiFact fact check on that question. And so that's new. They just started doing this. You can still get other things that say other things. but they do now try to highlight the fact checks themselves from these trusted organizations. Same thing with Facebook. This is new. This is me trying to post the Irish slave trade, the slaves that I think everyone forgets or something is the rest of the title. And I put the link in my Facebook. And this is what pops up, disputed by Associated Press and Snopes, right? To try to warn people away from posting things that have been fact-checked, right? Don't post this, bad information. And then probably you've seen a little box that started to show up on Facebook that had like tips and tools for fact-checking. Anybody see that box that popped up last week maybe? Or was I the only one who got it? Because they know I'm obsessed with fact-checking. Nobody else got it. Okay, you might see that soon, now that they know that you've been to the fact check workshop. Somehow they know everything. Okay, it became very politicized in the 2012 election, and I'm going to show you this thing that happened, and we'll look at the fact check of it too. So the first thing that happened was that the Romney campaign, perhaps mistakenly, said, "We are not going to let our campaign be dictated by fact checkers." And what they meant by that was that, you know, the opposition research of the Obama campaign and maybe also the nonpartisan fact checkers were saying things that Romney had said were wrong, misleading, whatever. And Romney said, "We're not going to care. We don't care." And so they sort of invited themselves to be fact checked even more. And then this thing happened during the second debate, causing a lot of controversy.
I think it's interesting the president just said something, which is that on the day after the attack, he went in the Rose Garden and said that this was an act of terror. You said in the Rose Garden, the day after the attack, it was an act of terror. It was not a spontaneous demonstration. Is that what you're saying?
Please proceed, Governor.
I want to make sure we get that for the record, because it took the president 14 days before he called the attack in Benghazi an act of terror.
Get the transcript.
He did, in fact, sir. So let me call it an act of terror.
Can you say that a little louder, Candy?
He did call it an act of terror. It did as well take 2 weeks or so for the whole idea of there being a riot out there about this tape to come out. You're correct about that.
The administration indicated that this was a reaction to a video and was a spontaneous reaction.
It did.
It took them a long time to say this was a terrorist act by a terrorist group. And to suggest, am I incorrect in that regard? On Sunday, your secretary, excuse me, the ambassador to the United Nations, one of the Sunday television shows, and spoke about how this was a spontaneous.
I'm happy to have a longer conversation about
Absolutely, but I want to move you on, and people can go.
Okay, so what just happened there? And did you feel uncomfortable? Because I still feel uncomfortable every time I watch it. Oh, yikes. So what happened there? So Candy Crowley is the moderator. And what does she do? She just jumps right in. Starts having conversation with both of them. Is that her job? A lot of people didn't think so. So that was really controversial. What does she do in her intervention, in her fact check? So the question is Benghazi, right? The question is, the attacks in Benghazi on September 11th, when Obama spoke about them, did he call them acts of terror, right? So the accusation by Romney is no, he did not. His defense is get the transcript, read for yourself, right? You'll see that I did. And what does she say?
She adds some context to it. Like, both of you are right, basically. He did say that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's sort of weird what she does, because at first she sounds like she's agreeing with Obama, and then she sort of agrees with Romney, and then you're just wondering, why are you talking? It's just not appropriate. And it kind of goes on too long, right? So let's see what happens, the fallout of it. So CNN, first of all, of course. So she's a CNN reporter. We have to be patient. I learned that last time. I tried clicking it too many times and it got mad at me. So hard to be patient. It's really hard to be patient. Okay, so CNN fact checks their reporter. And they say that a day after Libya attack, Obama described it as acts of terror, right? So they quote. So here's the showdown, and this is what they say. President Obama said he identified the September 11th assault on the U.S. consulate in Libya as a terrorist attack within a day. Romney said no, he didn't. So here's the claim, here's the counterclaim, here's the facts. They say on September 12th, the day after the attack that killed four Americans, Obama said in comments in the Rose Garden that he had learned about the attack on the consulate the night before, and then they give you a quotation from the transcript, right? So check the transcript. And you can see in the transcript it says, no acts of terror will ever shake the resolve of this great nation, right? So seemingly confirming Obama's take on it, right? Yes, sir.
So... Romney's argument, though, was that he didn't call it a terrorist attack by a terrorist organization.
Right.
And so that act of terror, I mean, a school shooting is an act of terror, but it's not
right.
A terrorist attack.
Right. I like the way you think. Hold that thought. Okay, so let's do our own fact check. Fact check CNN. So we're going to go to the American Presidency Project, which is a nonprofit organization run by professors. And what the American Presidency Project does is it provides us with everything ever said, more or less, by any president or person who is running for office. Once they get in office, then they backfill the stuff, right? So here is the American Presidency Project, Barack Obama, remarks on the attack, right, in Benghazi. We can check the date up at the top, which is September 12th. We can scroll down and see that the president spoke at 10:43 a.m. in the Rose Garden at the White House. So this is the speech that we're all talking about, right? This is the thing. And we can read the speech. And what we find when we read the speech is that it's actually really difficult to answer this question, that there's a lot of ambiguity. Right? Partially for what you identified. So he's giving a speech about 9/11 in part of it. He says, yesterday these four extraordinary Americans were killed in an attack. And then he says, we condemn it. Then he says, since our founding, we've been a nation that respects all faiths, blah, blah, blah. And then he says, it's especially tragic that they died in Benghazi, blah, blah, blah. And then he says, of course, yesterday was already a painful day for our nation as we marked the solemn memory of the 9/11 attacks. We mourned with the families that were lost on that day. Here's what I did. As Americans, let us never ever forget that our freedom is only sustained because there are people who are willing to fight for it, to stand up for it, and in some cases lay down their lives for it. Then he says, no acts of terror will ever shake the resolve of this great nation. So there's the phrase, no acts of terror. Is he calling Benghazi an act of terror? Or is he referring to 9/11? It's ambiguous, right? It's hard to judge. So on the one hand, CNN wants to advocate for their reporter, right, and defend what she did, and quotes this and says, he said acts of terror. And he did say the words acts of terror. But was he referring to Benghazi? It's hard to know. And what I want to bring up with this is just how difficult it is to make some of these judgments. It's certainly difficult to do it right in the moment during the debate, which is why she waffles, right, and says, oh yeah, no, he said it. Oh no, he didn't really say it, right, which doesn't make a lot of sense in the moment. So it's difficult to make that judgment, but it's also difficult upon reflection, right? It's difficult to look back at that speech and know exactly what he intended to say or what he did say. Yeah? Yes, sir.
I think the real problem is when you step back, it's not really that important of a comment, whether what he called it.
Right.
It's when you have two people just basically mudslinging at each other to make, just you want to make the other person look bad, then it matters. Are you
right.
A liar? No, I'm a liar.
Right. And that you're right. And that's what these debates end up being about. Not the debate, presidential debate, but these debates over whether you said it or you didn't say it. So the reason why Romney brings it up is because that's supposed to be emblematic. It's supposed to be a synecdochal part to whole relationship, right? He didn't say the words because he didn't do a good enough job protecting the nation, right? And so the not saying the words is supposed to represent this other thing. But you're right, when we end up just talking about whether or not the words were said and what they meant, we focus on kind of the minutiae of it instead of focusing on the policy of it. Yeah, which makes unproductive public conversation. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, that's right. Okay. But it's hard to tell, and it's certainly hard to judge, and it's certainly hard to deliver a verdict like yes or no on the spot. So here's the behind the scenes. I've only done one fact check or been involved in one fact check, and this is it. PolitiFact emailed me out of the blue one day, some reporter, and you can't read that, said, I'm checking the story and I wonder if you would give us your judgment, which I was surprised about, but was happy to do. And the story was about Bernie Sanders and some debate that the Democratic Party had during the primary, and one of the other people who was running, and I can't remember who now, Martin O'Malley said, when President Obama was running for re-election, Senator Sanders was trying to find someone to primary him. So trying to find some other Democrat to challenge Obama during the election. And then they provided me with a bunch of sources and statements from Sanders where Sanders said somebody should challenge Obama in 2012. And so I wrote, and that's all the research that I had. So they gave me lots of information and I basically just read their quotations that they had assembled. And I said, I think I would say this is half true. And the reason why I would say it was half true is because Sanders was saying somebody should primary him, but you can't say that Sanders actually went out and asked people to primary him, right? So half true. And so sure enough, I don't know why it's so slow today. So sure enough, when the PolitiFact comes out, they say half true. For the reasons that I identified. And so here's the fact check. I think they quote me in there somewhere. And if you look, oops, on the side, you should have, yeah, their sources. And so these are all the sources that they used in their story to make their determination. And you can click on those links too and follow them, which, as you now have seen, like, is a useful thing to do, because you might judge it differently yourself, right, after you read the transcript. And so if you're ever in doubt about some fact check or some fact, and you have the opportunity to read the information yourself, by all means do, because your judgment might not be the same as the professionals. But so in this instance, it's kind of reassuring to get the behind the scenes, because I have absolutely no interest in either O'Malley, whose name I couldn't even remember, or Sanders. And so, right, I have nothing at stake in rendering that judgment. Right? I'm just a professor who they asked to look at some quotations. So you can see that there's actually some impartiality in the process. So let's figure out how you can do your own fact-checking. I'm going to go through these tips, I'm going to go through these tips, and we're going to focus on this story in particular. It's a story that came out during the election. It was September 30th, 2016. Breaking, right? Big news. Tens of thousands of fraudulent Clinton votes found in Ohio warehouse. Why would that be a story that would circulate? Let me just tell you, it circulated a lot. So why would this be a story that would circulate? Yes, sir.
If it was published by Christian Times, people who are probably anti-abortion, considering Clinton's stances in particular that are just opposed to the standard.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with the Christian Times website? Do you read that?
No. So it's not necessarily something you trust personally, but like if you're just thinking about like for readers for why it would circulate. Because it turns out it was something some kid made up.
Ohio's
a battleground state. So why would that be important? Why would that make it circulate? Yeah, and so if they found fraudulent votes in Ohio, that would be a big deal because it would tip the whole election. Yeah, yeah. So we had two good reasons. Why else would it circulate?
Just because the title of it.
Yeah, breaking.
Breaking, it says fraud, Clinton.
Yeah, breaking fraud, Clinton,
and
yeah.
Warehouses.
Yeah. That's three good reasons. Anybody else got a reason for why they think this might circulate a lot? Why people would be like, yes. I can think of two other reasons.
A lot of people like to validate their beliefs.
Yeah.
I mean, half the time, I'll read a headline, I'm like on Facebook, like, oh, that's crazy. And then I look up at the source, and it's some crappy dinky website like this, and I'm like, oh, so I'm not going to even click on that.
Yeah. And during this context, Trump was saying that they were going to find voter fraud. Right? He said that if I lose the election, it's going to be because of voter fraud. And so here's the story. Here's the smoking gun. You're going to click that link because it confirms what you believe, because you've been told to believe it. And I can think of one other reason why this would have circulated. The photo evidence. Look at this. There's this guy behind all these ballot boxes. Right? Or you can see it right there. You can see it for your own eyes. Right? That this is the fraud that we've been waiting for. Yeah? So people saw this. They probably didn't read the story, or if they did, they saw Christian Times, and they thought, I believe that source, because it says Christian, and I'm Christian. They saw the evidence of the voter fraud. They saw the breaking news. They saw Clinton and fraud. They reaffirmed what they believed was true, right? Everything you said. And then they go, oh, man, Ohio, right? The election is lost if this happened in Ohio. Click the link, recirculate the link, right? It has all of the elements that you can think of. If you're going to reverse engineer a story that was designed to make people click the link and recirculate it, this is exactly what you would do, right? Turns out this is exactly what some kid, not much older than you, thought. And so we're going to go through all of these different fact-checking techniques, and we're going to show you, and I'm going to show you the New York Times article about the kid who wrote the story too. But so the first one is to go to the source directly for confirmation. So again, 6 out of 10 people don't actually click the link. They just recirculate it without checking. So one thing you can do is actually read the story. I'm going to go through that in a second. Seek confirmation from multiple sources. Use the Google reverse image search. Use the Internet Archive's Wayback Machine. Check the sources provided by the ad, person, or article. Read the fine print. So I'm going to go through each of these 6 things so that you know what I'm talking about. And I'm going to show you how, if you had done some of these things, you would have not recirculated this article. Even though everything about it screams, please recirculate me, right? Like, this is the smoking gun we've all been looking for. So go to this source directly. Where's the New York Times article? Sorry. I wanted to show you the article before I do all the things. So this is the New York Times article about this article. it wasn't published until January 13th, unfortunately, so too late to change the fact that everybody retweeted it. This is the kid right here, Cameron Harris, and he sat down and interviewed with the New York Times about it. He literally had just graduated from college. He didn't have a job. He wanted to do something in politics and public relations. And so, like Boris in, where was Boris from? Macedonia. Like Boris in Macedonia, he set up a bunch of websites to make some money. And so he tells the story of this story and how he wrote it. And so he's 23. And he literally went through all of the things that we just talked about. He was like, I need a good picture to prove my thing. I need to write something that's convincing. I know everyone right now is looking for evidence of voter fraud because of what Trump said. So let me write a story about that because everyone will want to click on that. Right? So literally just did all of the things and reverse engineered what it would take to get something to go viral. Yeah. And so you'll see one of my favorite things is he tells the story of the everyman. He says, at his kitchen table that night in September, Mr. Harris wondered who might have found these fraudulent Clinton ballots. So he invented Randall Prince, a Columbus area electrical worker. This everyman, a Trump supporter whose name hinted at a sort of nobility, had entered a little used back room at the warehouse and stumbled upon stacked boxes of ballots pre-marked for Mrs. Clinton. No one really goes in the building. It's mainly used for short-term storage by a commercial plumber, Prince said, right? So he creates this character, he gives him a name, he gives him a history, he gives him some words, right? Interviews him. He decided he needed a photograph. So he Googled ballot boxes, and what he found was, where is it? And what he found was, poor guy, what he found was, and I'll show you this, was some news story from Birmingham, England, and their election. And so the guy that you saw in the picture is actually a guy from England. Okay, so let's go back. So go to the source directly. According to the Ohio Secretary of State, John Husted, no one from this so-called news outlet bothered to call the Franklin County Board of Elections or the Ohio Secretary of State's office to verify any facts. It was a deliberate attempt to deceive and mislead. We already get enough of that from the candidates, enough already. And so if you read the story doesn't have any quotations from any official sources. It says something like, an investigation is ongoing, or we'll report back with more information soon, right? Something very vague, unreporterly-like. And that's a clue to you. That's a clue as a reader that, in fact, it's not a well-researched story. So when I showed you that chart and they had, you know, better research versus less well-researched, this would be an example of not good research. And one clue is that the only person quoted in the story is this one name. Somebody Prince, right? And so you could Google that and find out. Another thing is to seek confirmation. So you gotta ask yourself, did any other Ohio news organization have this story? Search out local news. If this was real, every news organization in Ohio and in the nation and probably in the world would be covering this story. So if the only place that's reporting it is something called the Christian Times, which you probably have never heard of because it's something that some kid just invented, you have to wonder if it's a real story. If it's not on CNN, then it's probably not real. So seek confirmation from multiple sources. Do you find other stories that quote Randall Prince from Columbus, Ohio about the story? Right? So every reporter who saw this would try to confirm the story. They would go back and they would try to find this guy. They would try to interview him. And even if they weren't able to because maybe he got shy about talking to reporters, they would still have a note in their story that said, we reached out to Mr. Prince and he was unavailable for comment. Right? So reporters would do that in their story. And so it's a way of checking a story yourself, right? Did anybody else confirm this story? Because everyone was trying to confirm it. Think about the Trump dossier. You guys remember the story of the Trump dossier from a couple of months ago? Yeah, salacious thing that some Russian spy or English spy or something put together this dossier. It started circulating around Washington, D.C. Nobody leaked it or published it until finally somebody did, even though it had been circulating in all of these different things, because nobody could confirm it. Everybody was trying to confirm it, but traditional news organizations won't publish unconfirmed gossip and innuendo. That's not what they do, right? Their norm is not to do that. And so they all had it. All these other reporters had copies of it and didn't publish it, because that's the way journalism works, or should work. So if you have something that's unsubstantiated by any other organization, know that they're all trying, right? They're all trying to get this story, and they would. Did you have a question? No. Okay, do a reverse image search. Has anybody done a Google reverse image search before? Yeah, a couple of you? Awesome. This is a trick that I honestly didn't know about until maybe 2 years ago, and maybe, I don't know, it didn't exist before then, but I think it's really cool. So with Google image search, you can either upload a photo into Google and it'll tell you what it is. So like if you're on a street corner or something, you don't know where you are, take a picture, Google tell you. Same, I don't know if that situation would really happen. But my thought is always like, I see this really pretty tree and I want to have that tree. And like, I don't know anything about flowers and trees. So like, let me take a picture of it and then upload it into Google and Google will just tell me what it is. Because nobody else knows usually either. But so here's the quotation from the New York Times story. And then here's the Google reverse image search. And what you're going to see is that it's actually going to link to the Christian Times story. So here is the Birmingham Mail, and they're having a very nice election in Birmingham. There's their polling station. There's some voters. They vote down at the pub. They vote in little manufactured things. And then here's our guy doing his job. Right? So if we right-click on any photo, we can search Google for image. And then they'll say, my best guess for this image is ballots found in Ohio. So that's the story from the Christian Times. And that's because that story circulated so much that it actually eclipsed the Birmingham news story. Right? So the Google associates this picture with the ballots found in Ohio. But that's not typically the case. So another example that I used to use before I did this one was from riots in Baltimore. And a bunch of people went on Twitter during the riots in Baltimore during the summer 2 years ago, I think, and posted all of these images of themselves supposedly looting and rioting, taking part of it. And it caused all of this controversy because people were like retweeting it and alerting the police, like this person has admitted guilt, and you know, it really sort of fomented this idea that it was widespread looting and that all of these people were taking part of it, and really sort of upped the anxiety about what had happened. And it turned out that if you did reverse image searches on it, you know, somebody had posted a photo of a destroyed Kentucky Fried Chicken. Turned out that destroyed Kentucky Fried Chicken photo was 10 years old, and it was from some other country, right? Somebody else posted a picture of a kid with a gun. Turned out that photo was 5 years old and from some other place, and you know, things like that. And I don't know why people would post photos like that and say that they were involved in doing things like looting when they weren't. But you can check that stuff, right, pretty easily with the Google reverse image search. You can also use the Internet Archive Wayback Machine. How many of you are familiar with the Internet Archive and their Wayback Machine? This is super cool. So the Internet Archive, first of all, is an archive of everything, not just things on the internet. They have video games from the 1980s you can play. They have movies you can watch. They have music. They have books that you can read. If you want to read most books, if they're in the public domain, they have copies of them. All digitized, you can download. So it's a great resource in general. It has a lot of stuff. But the Internet Archive also has an archive of the internet, which means that they literally go through the internet, they crawl the internet multiple times a day and take snapshots, working, functional copies of websites. Which is cool if you're ever doing a research project and you're like, how has Facebook, the Facebook, it used to be the Facebook, how has the Facebook changed since it started in 2002 or whatever it was? You can go back and look at their history of all the copies of the Facebook, or at least their logon page, because I think that's all you can really see, or whatever, right? If you're interested in how United Airlines is responding to the PR crisis, you might look at their website from last week and compare it to their website from this week and see if there's anything new, right? So it allows you to go back in time and look at information. And so we can use the Internet Archive Wayback Machine and check out the Christian Times website. I'm gonna click this link, but I'm pretty sure it doesn't work. It's a dead link, because this is the Christian Times. Uh-oh, what's it gonna do? Actually, I'm not gonna, because it's gonna freeze up my computer. So if you try to go to christiantimes.com or whatever it was, that website doesn't exist anymore. But if you search for it in the Wayback Machine, and right now you have to know the proper URL for the site you're looking for. They're starting to partner with Google to make it searchable, but I don't think it works quite right yet. So it's better if you know what the URL is. But so you'll see here that it was captured 32 times between October 1st and March 17th. And so October 1st is like right in the middle of the election when this kid was like, hey, I can make some money if I make some websites. And so he did. And then you just scroll down, and I think that that story came out October 10th, is that right? Is that what you guys remember? So let's go to their snapshot on the 13th. It's a little slow. I mean, this one's already slow, but, oh. Okay, so this is their website as it looked on that day. So clearly it's a anti-Clinton, pro-Trump website. Can't let her steal the election. Try to get rid of that. And then this is what the website had on it. You can see lots of breaking and busted and that kind of thing. Clickbait stuff. And then here's the original story. Oh, September 30th is when it came out. So I used the Internet Archive and went back and found the original story. And that's how it looked. So you can even, I'm not going to give them anyone's information. You can actually go back and read the comments and everything, which is interesting as like a research project. I would find that interesting. But so here it is. Here's the story that we've discussed. And look, there's ads. See? They're probably still making money off of us clicking this thing. So check the sources. Look for the article sources, the evidence. What if you were to read the story, they quote, according to sources, an affiliate in Ohio. But you want to believe it, right? So you do, but even though the evidence is clearly sketchy. They give you a picture. They give you the quotation from the one guy, Randall Prince, pictured, a Columbus area electrical worker. And also they rely on this already established suspicion that we all have. Then read the fine print. So check out the Christian Times About Us statement. One of you smartly said that one reason why you might recirculate this story is because maybe you're a Christian and it says Christian Times, and so you may be not familiar with it, but it says Christian Times and you're Christian, so you recirculate that. You trust that, you know, because no one would use that name, right? That wasn't telling the truth. But so if you look at the About Us statement, for the Christian Times, and I'm not going to show it to you because it's going to freeze up my computer. What happens if you click on the About Us, where they're supposed to, like, legally tell you who they are and who funds them, all that kind of stuff, if they're a real news organization, it pops up one of those join our email list things that you actually can't click out of. So you saw me click out twice. There's another one that pops up during the About Us that just covers the entire thing, and I'm not going to show you because you just have to trust me. But it'll freeze up my computer. So what I'm hoping you're going to take away with you is not only some techniques for how to do this, and hopefully I've taught you a couple of things that you didn't already know, and the importance of it, but also I really want you all to walk away thinking of yourself as a journalist and an editor and a publisher. So we have someone in the room who actually is a journalist, so she knows all these things that I'm telling you. But I want the rest of you to think of yourself as journalists too. Meaning that because of social media, we are all journalists, editors, and publishers. Every time we post something, we have the same power on social media that she has, or that, you know, someone from the New York Times has. Because you never know how your post is going to circulate. You have no control over it. And I've had it happen a few times where something I posted gets retweeted by someone who has a lot of followers, and it just, you know, you don't have any control. It just, you know, goes crazy, and you can't stop it from doing that, and you can't control it. So if that thing that I posted that started to recirculate was not true or, you know, mean or whatever, it's, you know, out of my hands. I can't take it back. Even if you delete the tweet or whatever, it's still there. It's still out there. And so this is from National Public Radio, Steve Inkeep. He said, what we all need as citizens is to develop more skill in applying our skepticism. I think y'all are good skeptics here. A couple of you really were like, no, I wouldn't. I disagree. I like that. So we need to spot false narratives and also turn aside those who would replace them with pure fiction. Either we get this right or we cease to be free citizens. It's really crucial. Remember we talked about that problem of having disagreement about policy and having disagreement about facts. How can we solve problems if we can't figure out some common ground, if we don't believe that the same things are true? And so it's really important that we figure out a way to be good critical thinkers of information and not recirculate bad information. Because the better our information is, the better we can solve problems as a country. This is a reporter motto that cracks me up, but I think is applicable here. If your mother says she loves you, check it out. Right? Check your sources. Find corroborating evidence. When I was a student in journalism, they said, you know, nothing's true unless you can find three people to verify it. Right? I don't know if they still tell you that. Is it three? Yeah, three. You need three. Because there's the person who said it, and then there's got to be two other people who know that thing too. Otherwise, it's not a fact. So if your mother says she loves you, you got to have two other people who also think your mom loves you. Here's how to avoid bias. Check out Media Matters, which monitors conservative media, and Media Research Center, which monitors mainstream media. right? Those are good resources that are sort of meta. They're checking the media. If you lean left, watch Fox News. Read the Wall Street Journal editorial page, the Weekly Standard, National Review, Reason Magazine. But also be aware and skeptical of things that are said on Alex Jones, Rush Limbaugh, and Breitbart. Not that you should distrust them. I think it's important to know what is being said on those sites, and those things have a lot of influence. We know that the President of the United States reads those news sources and is familiar with them. So it's important, I think, to be familiar with what's being said there. Otherwise, things will surprise you that are even said at all. If you lean to the right, tune in, same thing, right? Tune in to Rachel Maddow on MSNBC. Pay attention to Democracy Now. It's not that they're right, right? But if you are on one perspective, you want to know what's being said on the other perspective, no matter which side you're on. Or you can just pay attention to more middle-of-the-road things. One of the sources, I don't think I have it linked to here, but that I enjoy is the Wall Street Journal has an app called Blue Feed, Red Feed. Have y'all seen that? I like that. So what they do is, we know that the algorithm on Facebook provides us really polarized news content. They have each of us pegged as being liberal, conservative, in the middle, whatever, and they provide us news that fits what they think we are. So the blue feed, red feed shows you what Facebook looks like if it thinks you're a blue person or they think you're a red person, and you can see it side by side. So you can see just how polarized news looks based on the two perspectives. And one of the things that's really interesting is that sometimes these fake news sites, they're just trying to get clicks for cash, will own a left-leaning site and a right-leaning site. They'll post the same story with the same picture, different headline. And so it'll be like on the left and on the right at the same time, same picture, same story. They make money both ways, right, off of us. So here's that chart again with all of the different news sites. Again, you kind of want to stay in the middle, or at least be wary of the ones that are on the lower fringe on both sides. Know that if you're reading those sites exclusively, that you're getting a not very well researched and partisan perspective. Yes, sir. Where is it from?
Yeah.
That's a great question. And I don't remember right now. I know it was a professor of journalism, and I can't remember who. But I'll tweet it when I find it, when I get back to my office. Sorry, I should have that on there. Okay, so this is my last thing. Should I repost it? Is the source credible? You would know whether the source is credible or not by reading the article, right? Don't be the 6 out of 10 that post things without reading it. So is the source credible? You'll find that there are spoof sources, so it looks like ABC News, but it says abcnews.co instead of .com, and that is owned by somebody in some country that is not ABC News, right? So be careful with the websites. Is the story credible? So actually read the story, and then think about it a little bit. Like, think about whether it has sources that seem credible, whether it does the things that journalistic norms would dictate ought to be done, multiple sources, official sources, etc. Is the information relevant to your audience? That's another thing. You have to think about your followers or your friends as your audience. So is this story relevant to them? Is it clickbait? Is it something that's just trying to get them to click a link so that somebody else can make money? Is the headline clickbait or misleading? Is the story designed to evoke a purely emotional response? If it is, then it's trying to manipulate your friends. So why would you want to help somebody manipulate your friends? Finally, will your credibility suffer if you post it? So say, I don't know, in my world, what's his name? The guy from Rolling Stone, Matt Taibbi. So say Matt Taibbi from Rolling Stone, who has 450,000 followers, retweets you. Is that thing that he retweeted going to, because like 10,000 people are going to click it, right, or going to see it. Does that thing make you look bad? Is your credibility going to suffer if somebody happens to retweet it who has a lot of followers and influence? That's the kind of thing you want to think about, because it lives forever. Any questions? I know we're, yes, sir.
You mentioned something about looking where the link is, like the ending.
Yeah.
That also can be like different countries have different things. Like
yeah.
CA is Canada, .co.uk is British. So
yeah.
It doesn't necessarily discredit it as a source.
That's right. I don't know what CO is for as a source or as a link, but.
Yeah, I'm not sure either.
But it's definitely not the one that ABC News uses. And so that's the thing that's important. I don't know what that country is or what that link is. But thank you, that's helpful. Yeah, my mother-in-law is in Canada, my family's in Canada, and she recently had the same problem with the Costco website. Costco.ca is different from Costco.com. And she changed my password because she couldn't log on. Because she was on the wrong one. Happens. Other questions or comments? No? All right, well, thank you all for participating today. Please take some cookies with you on your way out. Just grab a cup and fill it up with cookies. Wherever you're going, they will like you better if you bring them cookies. And I hope to see you at another Aggie Agora event soon. Yeah, take water, take whatever.